Blackstone Audiobooks presents
The English Governess at the Siamese Court, being Recollections of 6 Years in the Royal Palace at Bangkok, by Anna Harriette Leonowens. Preface.
His Majesty's Somdech Pra Paramendra Maha Mongkut, the Supreme King of Siam, having sent to Singapore for an English lady to undertake the education of his children, my friends pointed to me.
At first it was with much reluctance that I consented to entertain the project. But strange as it may seem, the more I reflected upon it, the more feasible it appeared, until at length I began to look forward, even with a glow of enthusiasm, toward the new and untried field I was about to enter. The Siamese consul at Singapore, the Honourable W. Tan Kim Ching, had written strongly in my favour to the court of Siam, and in response I received the following letter from the king himself. English Era, 1862, 26th of February, Grand Royal Palace, Bangkok, to Mrs. A. H. Leonowens. Madam, we are in good pleasure and satisfaction in heart that you are in willingness to undertake the education of our beloved royal children, and we hope that in doing your education on us and on our children, whom English call inhabitants of benighted land, you will do your best endeavour for knowledge of English language, science, and literature, and not for conversion to Christianity. As the followers of Buddha are mostly aware of the powerfulness of truth and virtue, as well as the followers of Christ, and are desirous to have facility of English language and literature more than new religions.
We beg to invite you to our royal palace to do your best endeavourment upon us and our children. We shall expect to see you here on return of Siamese steamer Chow Pia.
We have written to Mr. William Adamson and to our consul at Singapore to authorise to do best arrangement for you and ourselves. Believe me, yours faithfully, S.S.P.P. Maha Mongkut. About a week before our departure for Bangkok, the captain and mate of the steamer Rainbow called upon me. One of these gentlemen had for several years served the government of Siam, and they came to warn me of the trials and dangers that must inevitably attend the enterprise in which I was embarking. Though it was now too late to deter me from the undertaking by any argument addressed to my fears, I can nevertheless never forget the generous impulse of the honest seaman, who said, "Madam, be advised even by strangers who have proved what sufferings await you, and shake your hands of this mad undertaking." By the next steamer, I sailed for the court of Siam. In the following pages, I have tried to give a full and faithful account of the scenes and the characters that were gradually unfolded to me as I began to understand the language, and by all other means to attain a clearer insight into the secret life of the court. I was thankful to find, even in this citadel of Buddhism, men, and above all women, who were lovely in their lives, who, amid infinite difficulties, in the bosom of a most corrupt society, and enslaved to a capricious and often cruel will, yet devoted themselves to an earnest search after truth. On the other hand, I have to confess with sorrow and shame how far we, with all our boasted enlightenment, fall short in true nobility and piety of some of our benighted sisters of the East. With many of them, love, truth, and wisdom are not mere synonyms, but living gods, for whom they long with lively ardour, and when found, embrace with joy. Those of my readers who may find themselves interested in the wonderful ruins recently discovered in Cambodia are indebted to the earlier travellers, Monsieur Henri Mouchot, Dr. A. Bastian, and the able English photographer James Thompson, F.R.G.S.L., almost as much as to myself. To the Honourable George William Curtis of New York, and to all my other true friends abroad and in America, I feel very grateful. And finally, I would acknowledge the deep obligation I am under to Dr. J.W. Palmer, whose literary experience and skill have been of so great service to me in revising and preparing my manuscript for the press. A.H.L. The dedication reads, "To Mrs. Catherine S. Cobb. I have not asked your leave, dear friend, to dedicate to you these pages of my experience in the heart of an Asiatic court, but I know you will indulge me when I tell you that my single object in inscribing your name here is to evince my grateful appreciation of the kindness that led you to urge me to try the resources of your country instead of returning to Siam, and to plead so tenderly in behalf of my children. I wish the offering were more worthy of your acceptance. But to associate your name with the work your cordial sympathy has fostered, and thus pleasantly to retrace even the saddest of my recollections amid the happiness that now surrounds me, a happiness I owe to the generous friendship of noble-hearted American women, is indeed a privilege and a compensation. I remain, with true affection, gratitude, and admiration, your friend A.H.L., 26th July, 1870. Chapter 1. On the Threshold.
March 15, 1862. On board the small Siamese steamer Chao Phya in the Gulf of Siam.
I rose before the sun and ran on deck to catch an early glimpse of the strange land we were nearing. And as I peered eagerly, not through mist and haze, but straight into the clear, bright, many-tinted ether, there came the first faint, tremulous blush of dawn behind her rosy veil. And presently the welcome face shines boldly out, glad, glorious, beautiful, and aureoled with flaming hues of orange, fringed with amber and gold, wherefrom flossy webs of colour float wide through the sky, paling as they go. A vision of comfort and gladness that tropical March morning, genial as a July dawn in my own less ardent clime. But the memory of two round, tender arms and two little dimpled hands that so lately had made themselves loving fetters round my neck in the vain hope of holding Mamma fast blinded my outlook. And as, with a nervous tremor and a rude jerk, we came to anchor there, so with a shock and a tremor I came to my hard realities. The captain told us we must wait for the afternoon tide to carry us over the bar. I lingered on deck as long as I could dodge the fiery spears that flashed through our tattered awning, and bear the bustle and the boisterous jests of some circus people, our fellow passengers, who came by express invitation of the king to astonish and amuse the royal household and the court. Scarcely less intelligent, and certainly more entertaining than these, were the dogs of our company, brutes of diverse temperament, experience, and behaviour. There were the captains too, Trumpet and Jip, who by virtue of their reflected rank and authority held places of privilege and pickings under the table, and were jealous and overbearing, as became a captain's favourites, snubbing and bullying their more accomplished and versatile guests, the circus dogs, with skipper-like growls and snarls and snaps. And there was our own true Bessie, a Newfoundland, great and good, discreet, reposeful, dignified, fastidious, not to be cajoled into confidences and familiarities with strange dogs, whether official or professional. Very human was her gentle countenance, and very loyal, I doubt not, her sense of responsibility, as she followed anxiously my boy and me, interpreting with her heart the thoughts she read in our faces, and responding with her sympathetic eyes. In the afternoon, when we dined on deck, the land was plainly visible. And now, as with a favouring tide we glided toward the beautiful Mae Nam, mother of waters, the air grew brighter and the picture lived and moved. Trees grew on the banks, more and more verdure. Monkeys swung from bough to bough, birds flashed and piped among the thickets. Though the reddish-brown water over the banks is very shallow at low tide, craft of moderate burden, with the aid of a pilot, cast anchor commonly in the very heart of the capital, in from 10 to 12 fathoms of water. The world has few rivers so deep, commodious, and safe as the Mae Nam, and when we arrived the authorities were contemplating the erection of beacons on the bar as well as a lighthouse for the benefit of vessels entering the port of Bangkok. The stream is rich in fish of excellent quality and flavour, such as is found in most of the great rivers of Asia, and is especially noted for its platou, a kind of sardine so abundant and cheap that it forms a common seasoning to the labourer's bowl of rice. The Siamese are expert in modes of drying and salting fish of all kinds, and large quantities are exported annually to Java, Sumatra, Malacca, and China. In half an hour from the time when the twin banks of the river, in their raiment of bright green, seemed to open their beautiful arms to receive us, we came to anchor opposite the mean, shabby, irregular town of Paknam.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.